We're going to study Revelation chapter 13, and before we get going, I would like to spend a little time in prayer. So if you don't mind, I'm going to just have us bow our heads. Father, I ask that you would please bless us as we enter into this time. Thank you for giving us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the protection of your angels. I ask that everybody who hears this message will be able to fully understand what saith the Spirit to the churches. Guide us, we pray, and do not allow me to speak a single word before this, your people, in Jesus' name, amen. In Revelation chapter 13, we have already seen one time where the Antichrist system, this portion being spoken of, has impersonated Jesus Christ. And we saw that they both have crowns, they both have horns, they both came up out of the water, they both look like the one before them, they both have names written on them, they were both crucified, buried and resurrected, and the whole world is wondering after both of them, etc. So we know that this power here is doing what it can to deceive the nations. Well, we looked at it that way. That's more of a symbolic kind of way to look at it, a more almost a characteristic type correlation. But this time we're going to use the Bible to interpret the Bible. For example, last time, or maybe not last time, but sometime before in this Revelation series, we talked about how a beast, according to Daniel chapter 7, verses 17 and 23, can actually be interpreted as a kingdom, a king or a kingdom. Okay, so we're going to use the Bible this time to interpret what the Bible is saying in regard to this Antichrist. This Antichrist here is the same power as what we find in Daniel chapter 7, Daniel chapter 8, Revelation 17, and also here in Revelation 13. So this Antichrist power, which is also mentioned in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, it is a, how would you say, a very vicious in deception power, okay? Vicious in being able to deceive. We've already seen that. I mean, it looks so much like Christ that you could actually ask the question, how would all the world wonder after the beast? And then you realize after seeing the correlations of how it's impersonating Jesus Christ, you say, oh, of course, it looks just like Christ in its characteristics, right? So as a result of knowing that we're going to be looking at the same chapter, but in a different way, let's begin in Revelation chapter 13. And Revelation 13, we've already read these verses before, but we're going to have to look at them through a different lens here. I stood upon the sand of the sea, it says in verse 1. I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. So this power here, first, as I said before, stands upon the sand of the sea. Now, Matthew 7 makes it clear that the sand is not a strong foundation. Matthew 7 says that a rock is the strong foundation. We know that Christ's, one of his characteristics is being a rock, okay? So Romans, you can read it in there, and there are other places of the Bible as well. The chief cornerstone is one of his titles. That would be a stone or a rock. So when you're looking at this prophecy, the foundation of this Antichrist power is not the rock, it is the sand. And then, of course, it says there's this beast that rises up. Now, because we've already looked at it, that a beast can be symbolically interpreted or prophetically interpreted as a nation, I'm just going to start using some of these terms after we see what the Bible says about them and being able to show you that you can actually read this portion in literal terms after the Bible describes what these symbolic prophetic terms are, okay? So I was standing upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a nation rise up out of the sea. Now, what is the sea? There's waters pictured in Revelation 17. Let's turn there real quick, Revelation 17, and we're going to look at verse 15 and see that the waters actually symbolize something. It says in Revelation 17, 15, he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the whore sits, are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. And you can see that waters represent groups of people all through the Bible, in the Psalms, in Isaiah, and other portions of the Scripture. But here, in the book of Revelation 17, 15, it plainly states that the waters represent people. And so this nation comes out of a populous area, a populated area, all right? A place where there are lots of people. It doesn't come up out of a place where there are few people scattered abroad. That's, I think, the point here that's being made. This nation comes up out of a populated area, it says in verse 1 of chapter 13, having 7 heads and 10 horns. 7 heads and 10 horns. We're going to get more fully into that when we look at Revelation 17, but we'll touch on it just right now. So look at your Bible in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 3. So we know that the power before this beast in Revelation 13, the beast, the dragon of chapter 12, they look a lot alike. But let's read it one more time in verse 3. There appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon. What did this red dragon have? 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. So this dragon of Revelation 12 has 7 heads and 10 horns. Okay? And then, of course, crowns upon his heads. Now, we know from Bible history that when Christ was on the earth, when he was just delivered, that King Herod, remember the story of Matthew chapter 2, sent out and destroyed how many children? All the children 2 years old and under. Why? Because he was trying to destroy this new upstart king that was going to take over his throne. And so why not kill it when it's a baby? In fact, I don't know which one it is, so kill them all. That to me sounds so satanic that of course it was the dragon that was illustrating this Roman power at the time. So what happens in verse 4, notice, of Revelation 12, verse 4. His tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. Here's the point. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was the church that had Christ in her belly, which was ready to be delivered. Why? For to devour her child as soon as it was born. And how did that happen? The attack to devour Christ when he was born was the Roman power that tried to destroy Christ when he was born in somewhere around the year zero, or there's no year zero, so -2 really probably was it, -4, -3, -2, somewhere in there. But that's when Christ would have been attacked by this Roman power. So now jump over to Revelation 17 for a second and notice what happens in verse 3. Revelation 17, verse 3. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon the scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having what? 7 heads and 10 horns. Now, what's interesting about this one, it doesn't have any crowns on its heads or horns. You see? So what we have is in Revelation 12, we have this 7-headed beast with 10 horns, but it has crowns on its heads. In Revelation 13, you have this power that has 7 heads and 10 horns with crowns on its horns. And in Revelation 17, you have this beast with 7 heads and 10 horns, but no crowns. Okay. There's a little bit of a difference there, and you can kind of see what's going on when you understand Bible history, and guess where a lot of this good information will come? You've probably heard me say it again, or say it before, in this amazing book that if you haven't read, you've got to pick it up and read. It's called The Great Controversy, okay? That book is so powerful. Well, it describes the history of all this working and inner working of these powers that not only the Lord uses, but the enemy uses as well, you see? So, you know, we're going to notice from the Bible that it's pretty clear that you have this Antichrist power run by demonic authority. We're going to see that in just a moment. And it still has a future purpose for the world. Now, does that mean God hates the people in this power? What do you think? Yes or no? No, absolutely not. The church has described that. In fact, when it talks about those that were in the churches, it says that God hated the deeds of the Nicolaitans in chapter 2, verse 5, and or 6, rather. And then in chapter 2, verse 15, God hated the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. He hated the deeds and the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, but he didn't hate the Nicolaitans, you see. Now, God hates the deeds and the doctrine of the Antichrist. He doesn't hate the people of the Antichrist. Neither should we. I don't. I love people that are in Babylon, okay? The scriptural term for the Antichrist and his cohorts. Babylon. Somebody that doesn't fully understand or follow the truth would be clumped into the group called spiritual Babylon. I love people in Babylon. I don't love their deeds or their doctrine, you see. There's a big difference there. And you can kind of see that with the Nicolaitans in chapter 2 of Revelation. So in the same way here, God loves these people, as we should as well, but he hates the deeds and the doctrine. Notice as we go back to Revelation chapter 13, and reading in verse 1, it says that this nation with the shifting foundation of sand, it comes up out of a populated area. It has 7 heads and 10 horns. Now, what that means is it has the identical characteristics of the nation before it. That would be Rome. The Roman nation that tried to take the life of Christ when he was a baby, coming just forth out of the womb, is the nation that's being spoken of, the 7-headed dragon with 10 horns. That one is here pictured, and the characteristics are so similar, you can say only that it has the same characteristics of Rome. You see what I'm saying? So now, if it looks just like Rome, it's got the 7 heads and the 10 horns. It's a little different than Rome in that it said at the end of verse 1, it had crowns upon its heads. It says that there's 10 horns and upon his horns 10 crowns. So here in this chapter, in this verse, we have horns on the crowns. The previous beast or dragon had crowns on the heads. Now, I could say that you could look at this in that it represents 2 phases of time. Okay? Just like what we saw in Revelation 12. The Roman power in Revelation 12 had a time before the 1260 days. Remember that? Where he was chasing the woman with Christ in her belly. And then there was that war in heaven. And then you see that time, that 1260 days, or 42 months, or time and a half of time, whichever way it's mentioned there, in seven different times in Daniel and Revelation. You have that 1260 days that's mentioned again in Revelation 12. Now, what happens first is you see the activities of Rome, this dragon power, before the 1260 days. Then you see the dragon power during and after the 1260 days, where he was still chasing the woman, but Christ wasn't in the woman's belly. Christ was in the woman's heart, you see, because that's what happens now. We have this new covenant with God that the law is within our minds and in our hearts. The law represents Christ and his character. We'll have his name on our foreheads. Remember, this is all about God being in our character, or our characters, rather, being like God. I'd rather say it that way. I don't want to say it the other way, because forget it. Never mind. I think you'll understand what I meant. So what we see in Revelation chapter 12 is there's the beginning of this Roman power before the 1260 days. And then there's another experience of this dragon or Roman power after the 1260 days. Okay? And you can see a similar thing with the crowns being on the heads in chapter 12 and on the horns in chapter 13. There's one means of activity, and there's another means of activity. Okay? Just like in chapter 12, there's 2 phases. In Revelation 12 and 13, there's 2 phases of the same character, or the same nation, Rome. Rome had 2 phases. You can see that very clearly also in the book of Daniel. Let's continue looking here and see that it says there was a name written on the heads in chapter 13, verse 1. The name was blasphemy. Now, let's understand again what the term blasphemy can mean. Now, turn in your Bible to Ezekiel chapter 20. I believe we've done this before, but it would be well to have a refresher. Ezekiel 20, and the Bible says in verse 27, "Therefore, son of man," in verse 27 of Ezekiel 20, "speak unto the house of Israel and say unto them, thus saith the Lord God, yet in this your fathers have blasphemed me." How, God? "In that they have committed a trespass against me." So sinning against God is committing blasphemy against God. Now be nimble with your fingers and turn to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2, and we're going to see another description the Bible gives of blasphemy. Sometimes the Bible uses the word blasphemy where it doesn't give a direct definition of that term. It can give you circumstances where the term can be used. But here in these three sections, Ezekiel, Mark, and then we're going to be turning to the book of John, there's actual biblical definitions. Okay, so Mark chapter 2 and looking at verse 7, the Pharisees, they hear what Christ said to this man that was sick, and he said, Jesus basically had said, "Son, thy sins be forgiven thee." And in verse 7, the Pharisees said, "Why does this man thus speak?" What? Blasphemies. "Who can forgive sin but God only?" That's the question. So if you are breaking God's law, if you're sinning against God, you're committing blasphemy. If you're claiming to forgive sin, you're committing blasphemy. Let's look at one more in John chapter 10. John chapter 10 and looking at verse 33. Jesus had just mentioned to the Pharisees again, he's speaking to them, and the Jews were round about him, it says in verse 24, but verse 33, he says, well, he had just said, "My Father and I are the same, we're one, and you can't pluck me out of my Father's hands. All these things, I've showed you these wonderful works." But in verse 33, notice what they said. The Jews answered him, "For a good work, we're not going to stone you, but because of blasphemy, and because that you, being a man, are claiming to be God." Okay? You're making yourself God. So the biblical definitions of blasphemy can be sinning against God purposefully when you know better, claiming to forgive sin, and claiming to be God. Okay? So what is the Antichrist power doing here in Revelation chapter 13? You can find out more in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. So turn there to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we're going to see in our Bibles that this Antichrist power is referred to in this section as well. You see, there was going to be a falling away, but before the falling away and before the coming of the day of the Lord, not before the falling away, but before the coming of the day of the Lord, there was going to be the son of perdition revealed. And it says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4, this son of perdition, he opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he, the Antichrist, this man of sin, the son of perdition, he as God sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Okay, so if you're a man and you're claiming to be God, what are you committing? Blasphemy. Okay, so in Revelation 13, verse 1, where it says that he has the name of blasphemy written on him, he's claiming to forgive sin. He's breaking God's law, though he knows better, and he is also claiming to be God. You see? So in verse 1, where it talks about this name of blasphemy being written on his head, of course, so far we can see in this biblical passage, Revelation chapter 13, verse 1, he's sitting on the shifting sand of tradition. It's not the word of God. It is not Christ as his foundation. And he is a nation that has come out of a populated area. He is Roman in his characteristics. In fact, so similar, you could call him Roman. And upon his 10 horns, there are crowns. It's a little bit different than the start of the Roman power. He's got these different characteristics, and some of those characteristics would be blasphemous in that he claims to forgive sins and he claims to be like God. Okay? So let's look at verse 2. The beast which I saw was like unto a leopard. His feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power, his seat, and great authority. Now, when the Bible talks about this nation or this beast looking like other nations, you have to ask yourself, why does that happen? What's the deal here? Well, we already saw that Christ looks like a leopard, a bear, and a lion, right? We saw that in Hosea chapter 13. But guess what? This beast also looks like a leopard, bear, and a lion in that Christ looks that way. That was his main purpose. But in another way, you can see it as well. Because in Daniel chapter 7, I'm not going to turn there. I'm just going to explain it. Daniel chapter 7, it starts out with a lion. It goes then to a bear. It then goes to a leopard. It talks later in the fourth beast or fourth creature as this beast that doesn't even have a name. He didn't even want to call it. He just called it this hideous creature that comes up. And it talks about its different characteristics. Well, you can see in the Bible, Daniel chapter 2 specifically, where Daniel chapter 2 giving the interpretation of those four metals, not four beasts, but four metals, meaning the same exact things. The first metal and the first beast represented Babylon, okay? The next metal and next beast represented Medo-Persia. These are world-ruling powers that persecuted God's people. And then the next beast represented Greece and the next metal as well. Finally, the fourth, and you can see those, by the way, the second and third, clearly spelled out in Daniel chapter 8. In fact, it actually calls it Grecia and Medo-Persia, just that plainly. That's in Daniel chapter 8, verses 20 and 21, if you want to check it out. So the fourth creature, or the fourth metal, is the one that's mentioned last in the four successive kingdoms. It's the one that rules the whole world, specifically persecuting God's people. My question is, which one did come after Greece that persecuted God's people in such a way? Well, of course, Rome did, right? That's where we come into the book of Revelation in chapter 12. Rome is there. It was during the time Christ was here on earth. Now, what's interesting is this Revelation 13 prophecy, it goes from a leopard to a bear to a lion. Daniel's prophecy goes from a lion to a bear to a leopard. Did you see that? Okay, Revelation goes from a leopard to a bear to a lion. Daniel's prophecy in chapter 7 goes from a lion to a bear to a leopard. Why? What's the deal? Daniel was writing in the 500s BC. He was in the time of Babylon looking forward. He was looking forward in time, and God was showing him things that would be coming in the future, far after he was dead. These are what we call prophecies, okay? So this prophecy was revealing these nations that would come up in the future. Well, by the time John was here on earth, 500-something years later, what happens is John is in the time not of Babylon, but of Rome. And so what's happening is he's looking backward in time. And that's why he sees first the leopard and then the bear and then the lion. Because Daniel was over here looking this way. John is over here looking that way. Okay, you see how that works? Now, what's interesting is, in this prophecy, you only have three creatures mentioned. The leopard, the bear, and the lion. Wait a minute, there were four in Daniel. There was that fourth terrible beast, which was Rome. Guess what? This beast in of itself is Rome, isn't it? That's why you only have three specifically mentioned. It's because the fourth one, the one that is made up of all those different beasts, is Rome itself. Now, why would it be made up of all these creatures? Well, of course, it would be mostly leopard-like because it just came out of Greece, right? Because it conquered Greece. So if Greece is ruling and this nation called Rome overtakes it, a lot of that nation will be part of Rome, right? The customs, the characteristics, the economy, the people, the language. What more do you want to talk about? So of course it's going to look most like Greece. And it will look a little bit like Medo-Persia because Greece overtook Medo-Persia and carried along with it all the different characteristics and the traditions and the on and on and on. And of course it would look somewhat like Babylon because Babylon was overtaken by Medo-Persia, which took that with it, which was taken over by Greece, which took that with it, which was overtaken by Rome, which took that with it. So that's why it looks like all these creatures. It's a conglomeration of the three nations before it, except it's its own being, being the fourth creature in Daniel chapter 7, which is Rome. That's why it has seven heads and 10 horns, because the power right before it in chapter 12 of Revelation is Rome. Do you get it? Okay, now, this beast here must be different in that it specifically has the name of blasphemy on it. And we can see how clearly it tries to follow the characteristics of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And so this is not a regular, normal power. This is a political, yes, but also very religious, spiritual power, isn't it? It's claiming Christ as one of those on its side. That's why it has the name of blasphemy. Well, we can forgive sin. We can be God on earth. And we can break the law and know better because we are claiming to be God. We can change the law, right? That's basically what's being said. Now, we can go on and on. I think I've probably said enough to help the thinking person understand that Rome in its first power, or first, how would I say, form, Revelation chapter 12, the first portion, while he was chasing the woman with Christ in her belly, that would be pagan Rome, okay? Well, during the 1260 years and after, where this same dragon is chasing the woman, but not with Christ in her belly, but rather Christ in her heart, that power is different. That's why it's pictured here, specifically, in and of itself. It's different in that it's religious. That's why it's different in two phases there of Revelation 12. That's why it's different in two phases in the book of Daniel. In fact, in Daniel chapter 8, you can see that he's searching around east, west, north, and south. But then all of a sudden, he switches, and his focus goes upward. So there's a lateral focus, and there's a horizontal focus. That's where you can see the differences there in the book of Daniel, where you can see that, yes, he is pagan, political only, and then he becomes religious. Okay? Well, here, this is the religious portion of Rome. We call papal Rome. There's pagan, there's papal Rome. I've got a bunch of notes here on this stuff. I've preached a lot of sermons, so I'm not covering all the details in this message here, but trust me, there are other messages online. You can request, what about this portion? And it's probable I've either heard it from somewhere else and I can give you somebody who's spoken about it that way, or perhaps I've sent it that way, said it that way as well, and you can hear various thoughts on it. But I'm not going to cover it in all detail because I'm telling you, I have put together more than 40 different biblical characteristics of the Antichrist. I've put them all together. I've got a list. Actually, I don't have a list. I have it in two different studies, but I could easily put them together in one list, and you could have all 40 in your hands, and you can go through all what the Bible says about the Antichrist, and you can come to the same conclusion I have. It is the papal or second phase system of Rome. Papal Rome, the religious aspect of Rome that is fulfilling the Antichrist power. Now, let's continue on and see if what I'm saying is true or I'm a total heretic. All right? Now, it says in Revelation chapter 13, verse 2. I think we haven't read it yet, so let me read it. The beast, which I saw, was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon, the beast before him, which represents Rome, gave this new beast his power and his seat and great authority. Now, my question is, in history, could we find that the beast before this one, which was the Roman power of Revelation chapter 12, could we find that that power, the Roman power, gave power, seat, and great authority? The word seat can be throne. Power, seat, and great authority. Could we find that? The answer is absolutely yes. If you go back into history, just go to that one book that I gave you all, that I told you all about, The Great Controversy, you'll find written in there, and even found in history, there are portions that describe the civil authority of Rome giving over complete civil authority to the papal power of Rome. That's why we call it the Roman Catholic Church, is because the Roman Papal Church, or the papal see, the papal system, was given total authority during the time of the beginning of the Dark Ages, you see. And it was during that time that the 1260 years that we talked about so many times began. It was in 538. I know these names, but I'm not going to say it because I'm not sure that it's the right name. But there was leaders of the Roman system that gave the Pope total not only ecclesiastical but civil authority, and from that point forward, having the power of both church and state moved forward for 1260 years. Okay? So yes, the Roman power did give this new beast that's made up of all four that we saw in Daniel both power and a throne, that would be the civil authority, and great authority. And of course, they had worldwide authority at that time. The then known world was there in Europe. So in verse 3, the Bible says, I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. Now, did the political power of Rome that had been given from the, did I say religious? Did the religious political power of Rome that had received political power from the Roman system before it, did it ever receive a deadly wound? The answer is yes. And that is what happened exactly 1260 years later. Okay, so between verse 2 and 3, there are 1260 years that pass by. Just that quickly. If you know that the seat and great authority and power was given over to this beast, and then all of a sudden this beast receives a deadly wound, when was it? It was after the 42 months that's spoken in verse 5. It was after the 1260 days. And what happened then? This name I do remember. It was General Berthier, under the rulership of Napoleon Bonaparte. They were French, and Bonaparte had led his armies into the area. They were able to take the Pope captive. They were able to bring him out of the authority of civil and religious leadership, put him into a cage, if you will, a pen, a prison, and he was left there. They didn't want to kill him. They thought this was a really holy man. They didn't want to kill him, but they knew that they didn't want him to have the same authority. So they left him there to die after several years being in this exilic cage, okay, or prison. So he actually did receive a deadly wound, this Antichrist power. What does this deadly wound mean? Well, his civil and religious authority was taken away from this system, the Antichrist or papal system. The system no longer had political and religious worldwide authority. And as a result, their authority or power was taken away. They had a deadly wound. Now, what's interesting is the Bible says that deadly wound, just like typified in the life of Christ, would be healed, you see. Rather, typifying the life of Christ, I should say it that way. So, was there and will there be a time where this deadly wound was and is being healed? The answer is yes, in a start. It hasn't completely been given yet. I don't believe that civil and political authority worldwide has been given to this power yet, but it is coming, believe you me. I say, on authority of the Bible, that the Roman Catholic Church will have worldwide political and religious authority again. We can look around today, right now, as I stand here speaking, and we can see that with the troubles in the world, if there was ever a call for a religious leader. Everybody on the face of the earth, well, the majority of the people on the face of the earth, would point to one man. That one man being who? The Pope. I fully believe that he will receive, according to the Bible and its prophecies, that authority again. Now, there is one portion that I'll read to you. It's from, I'm just going to read it and then I'll tell you where it's from. The Pope is again an independent sovereign ruler, as he was throughout the Middle Ages, though his temporal realm, established today, is the most microscopic independent state in the world and probably the smallest in all history. Now notice, the Pope is again an independent sovereign ruler, as he was throughout the Middle Ages. That's true. He is now the same king-priest. He's both a king and a priest right now. But the thing is, he doesn't have world ruling authority like the previous Antichrist power did, the main system, if you will, before the deadly wound. When he receives the full-blown authority again, and when they establish laws that are contrary to God and bring up persecution in the same ways, etc., that's when, of course, they will have this deadly wound completely healed. But this was taken from the New York Times, Tuesday, February 12th, 1929. That wasn't very long ago, and the New York Times generally has credible sources. So what's fascinating is that in 1798, which was the year they received the deadly wound, it was a short time later, they were given that, at least the start of that deadly wound healed. Italy came together with the Roman Church and said, you know what, we'd like to give you the same authority that you had before, and they now have it, except it's not worldwide. So that's where the deadly wound began to heal. There's a Band-Aid, if you will, on it, but it's not completely healed yet. Revelation chapter 13, verse 3. I saw one of his heads that were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world wandered after the beast. All I can say is that I have not only seen videos and pictures, but I have personally been to the same location where the Pope has shown up. That is not, listen to my words, that is not a small ordeal. When you have to call out the American Secret Services, when you have to plan years in advance, when you have to organize an entire state, when you have to gather police officers, military agents from the army, from the military, from the SEALs, from everywhere, when you have to have helicopters and special planes, when you have to have limousines with Secret Services, as I mentioned, going parading before and after, when you have flags raised with motorcycles and police officers on those motorcycles making big hoopalas, and you have all of the radio and broadcasting stations focusing on that point where there's nothing you hear about for several days on any of the media except that, I think we can say, just from what I explained just now, it's pretty simple to say that yes, all the world is wandering after the beast. Now, the word wander, the word is spelled the same, but meaning two different things in the English language. You can wander after, which means you could actually walk after, or you can mentally wander after something. The word here is mentally wander, okay? These people are wandering after the beast. And it's pretty simple to know that, even today, guess who has the most influential Twitter account on the face of the planet. The Pope does. When he speaks, people listen. Okay? Now, so let's ask just a few questions just to see if what I'm saying is heretical or not. Is there foundation shifting as the sand? And I could say with tradition, the answer is yes. They are completely traditional. They are not biblical historic. Okay? They do not follow the Bible with their foundation. Is it a nation? Yes. Did it come out of a populated area? And it gets even more specific in the book of Daniel. The answer is yes. It was Europe. Did it have two phases? The answer is yes. One papal, I'm sorry, pagan, and the next one papal, or how would you say, humanistic and religious? You could say it that way. Verse 2, did it look mostly like the leopard because it overtook Greece? Yes. Is it impersonating Christ in all its different activities? Well, yeah. You have priests, right? Jesus is a priest. And they use bread in their services, right? The transubstantiation, which we're told Jesus is the bread of life. Do they use wine for the communion services? They use wine, of course. The real stuff where Jesus even used the new wine, as the John chapter 2 and Matthew chapter 27 says. So do they have incense like Jesus did in the sanctuary service? Of course. Do they have magnificent temples made up of gold and marble and beautiful tapestries and these different things? Of course, yes, they do. Do they have various things carved out of gold and beautiful emblems inside their temples? Of course, just like the sanctuary here on earth. You see, all the things that they're doing are impersonating or just like what Christ is doing in the heavenly temple. That's why we can say, according to the Bible, they have all the characteristics of Jesus. On the earth, they have all the characteristics of the sanctuary. You see, it's so absolutely clear that there's no way around it. So the question is, no wonder it looks like a leopard because it overtook Greece. And it was the dragon or Roman power the one that gave him seat, power, and great authority? Yes, it was. You can find that in history. Did it ever receive a deadly wound? Yes, it did, of course, when its political and religious authority was taken away in 1798. Did that wound ever heal or begin to heal? Yes. That happened in 1929 with the Latin cordant, I can't remember how to say that word. Cordonat? It's not an English word, so I don't know how to say it exactly. Concordat. There it is, concordat. And then, let's see. Is all the world wandering after the beast? Yes, unfortunately, that's true. I really wish all the world would wander after Jesus Christ, the true Savior. But see, what's happening is the enemy is using this power to look so good. There's nothing wrong with wanting to heal the earth, right? Taking care of the environment. There's nothing wrong with wanting to feed the poor and take care of those that are ill. There's nothing wrong with wanting to keep the families together, right? These are good things. And that's what's happening is the system right now is focusing on those things. And what's happening is they're using those good things to cloak all the doctrine that they have that they themselves claim will never change. Their doctrine doesn't change. Their face does. You see? They look better than they are. Check it out for yourself. Get yourself a catechism. Read through that and know the Bible at the same time, and you're going to see some stuff in there that is very different than what the Bible teaches. And they're going to stick to that much more than the Bible. Okay? Do your own homework. I'm not doing all your homework for you. I'm just trying to open up your eyes a little bit. So it says there in verse 4, they worshiped, they being those that wandered after the beast, they worshiped the dragon. Now, yes, that's Roman, but I think what we're referring to here most is the dragon of Revelation 12, the second part there, or the interlude part where Christ is warring with the dragon in heaven, and the dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan. I think they're worshiping him more than the Roman power, if you will. Okay, so they worshiped the dragon, which is the one that actually gave power unto the beast. And they worshiped the beast. Remember, the beast is Antichrist, the one that looks just like Jesus. And so they're worshiping this looks just like Jesus creature or Antichrist system. And they're asking, who is like unto the beast? A similar way you can look at that, remember, with the Michael scenario. Who shall be able to make war with him? You know, Revelation 17, at the end of that, toward the end of that chapter, talks about a war where all the kings or all the nations, the horns will gather together and they will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them. Yes, there's going to be war, but I want to be on the Lamb's side, Jesus Christ. What about you? I want to know the Bible and follow it with no traditions keeping me back from following a thus saith the Lord. What about you? So that's what we're here for. We want to learn the truth. We want to know and understand that God loves these people in the Roman Catholic Church. He loves everybody in the Jewish tradition. He loves everybody in the, let's say, Methodist, in the Lutheran, in the Calvinist. He loves everybody in the Islamic. He loves everybody in the Jehovah's Witness or the Latter-day Saints. He loves all these people. If their doctrine is contrary to the Bible, he does not love their deeds or their doctrine, but he loves the people. Are you with me? That's what the Bible teaches. He loves every one of us, and he wants us to understand what the Bible teaches. That's why we're here. We want to learn what saith the Lord. So let's continue for a moment. Verse 5. There was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. And power was given unto him to continue 42 months. That 42 months, if you multiply 42 by 30, you get 1,260. Okay? A time, which is 360, times, which is 720, add those together with a half a time, you get 1,260. So you have this 1,260 scenario happening seven different times in Daniel and the book of Revelation. And here we have this Antichrist power ruling, persecuting God's people, blaspheming God's name for 1,260 years. Remember, after that 1,260 years, he gets a deadly wound that is later healed. He's not done yet. This Antichrist system is not finished yet. He's acting more today like what we see in Revelation 17. And of course, he's going to replay all the activities that we see here as well. We're not done with this power yet. It's a very serious thing, talking about the Antichrist system, because we're living, being what we can, doing what we can to be faithful in God's will, knowing his word, where we are fully surrounded worldwide by the Antichrist system and those that worship him or the beast and follow after him or wonder after him. So the Bible continues on in verse 6. He opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name, which is his character, his tabernacle, which is his sanctuary, and them that dwell in heaven, which are those his people. So the Bible continues on in Revelation 13. I'm just going to skip back there because I got mixed up for a second. It says that he was blaspheming against God. Now, I have a couple of quotes here that I'd like to read one to you. This is taken from John A. McHugh and Charles Cullen. It's from the Catechism of the Council of Trent for Parish Priests. This is taken from page 82 and 83. This is from a reprint in 1992. Notice what it says. Regarding the forgiveness of sins, quote, if we look to its ministers, its being the Roman Catholic Church, or to the manner in which it is to be exercised, the extent of this power will not appear so great. For it is a power not given to all, the power to forgive sins, but to bishops and to priests only. And sins can only be forgiven through the sacraments when duly administered. The church has received no power otherwise to remit sin. So it's basically saying that we have the power to forgive sin, and it's through the sacraments, but it's not given to everybody, only to the priests and the bishops. That's amazing, isn't it? In their own writings, reprinted recently, this is something that they claim in a catechism. This is what they teach people that are going to join the church. And they claim that we can forgive sin. Of course, are they claiming to be God? Yes, they're claiming to be God. They're blaspheming his name, his tabernacle, and them that dwell therein. Taken from the Converts Catechism, this is a different one. This is from the year 1946, page 50. It says, this is a question and answer session. Question, which day is the Sabbath day? The answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church, in the Council of Laodicea, which was AD 336, transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Question, Why did the Catholic Church substitute Sunday for Saturday? Answer, well, the church substituted Sunday for Saturday because Christ rose from the dead on Sunday and the Holy Ghost descended upon the apostles on a Sunday. Question, by what authority did the church substitute Sunday for Saturday? Answer, the church substituted Sunday for Saturday by the plenitude of that divine power which Jesus Christ bestowed upon her. Basically, they're saying, and they'll say this in many different other ways, you can find this all through their writings, they're saying we have the same authority on earth as God. They actually call themselves the vicar of God or the ambassadors of God on earth, God in the flesh, okay? So they are saying we have the authority to change God's law because we are God on earth. That's why they were saying, yes, it's Saturday, but we've changed it by our own authority. So from their own catechism, you can read for yourself and be amazed that, yes, they are fulfilling these blasphemous claims that the Bible teaches the Antichrist will fulfill. Verse 7. It was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. Now here is what you're going to find in the book of Daniel as well. He is a world-ruling system, the Antichrist power. Not only did he make war with the saints, as it says in verse 7, but he continued over the whole world, over every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. Now, this war over the saints, what does this mean? I've mentioned it before during this series, but I've read the book entitled Fox's Book of Martyrs. This book is extremely heavy with very explicit descriptions of what was occurring during the Dark Ages, where people were being persecuted by the Roman papal power. It is not for children. I'm telling you, this is very serious descriptive language. And it is said that anywhere from 50 to 75 million people were tortured and killed. When I say tortured, that is one word that describes, I could use 15 other terms to try to describe what I mean by the word tortured, okay? Anything you can think of and worse. I'm tempted to just give you one example. I'm not going to do it. You can do your own homework. But listen, 50 to 75 million, they don't even know the names of some of these folk, were killed during this time by the Roman Catholic Church. Why do you think it was within this year that I'm speaking that the papal system went to the Waldensian Valleys in Italy and personally apologized for the treachery they caused against those that were Bible believers during the Dark Ages? Because they know with their own, in their own history that they persecuted these people. That's only one group. There are so many other millions and millions of people that were tortured to death as a result of the traditions held by the Father. I don't think that's okay. I think this is awful. The reality is that this beast power, this Antichrist power, yes, it persecuted in the past when it was given the ability to make war with the saints and it overcame them. But yes, it will do the same in the future because we're told, according to the Bible, they're going to have world ruling authority again. Look at verse 8. All that dwell on the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Now, let's see what is meant by this being in the book of life. Exodus chapter 32, verse 33. Exodus 32, 33. Notice what the Bible says. Moses is actually interceding for the people. Exodus 32, 33. The Lord said unto Moses, when he was interceding for those that were at the base of the mountain, whosoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. So you can lose your place in the book of life. Him that hath sinned against me is the one I'm going to take out of the book. Notice what it says there in verse 8 of Revelation 13. All those that dwell on the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life If their names are not in the book of life, it is because they are sinning against God. My Bible teaches in 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, that breaking the law of God is sin. Okay? Transgression of the law is sin, or sin is transgression of the law. So these people here are not following the law of God, and as a result, their names are not written in the book of life. So what do we need to conclude from this? We must, by God's grace and with the Holy Spirit filling us, keep the law of God. If we do not, we are simply following the traditions of men, and our names will not be written in the book of life. The Bible says in verse 9 of Revelation 13, if any man hath an ear, let him hear. The Bible says very similarly in Ezekiel chapter 3. It's in your notes. You can read it later. Verse 10. He that leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He that kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Now, what's interesting about this in verse 8, where it says that you will not have your name written in the book of life if you're following after this beast, that means you're not following the commandments. It makes it pretty clear that this power that was leading into captivity and killing with the sword will also be led into captivity and will be killed with the sword. But then notice at the very end of that section, verse 10, where it says, here is the patience and the faith of the saints. That is taken from two other portions of the book of Revelation. Let's read them very quickly. Notice what it says in Revelation 14, verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. Notice it said in chapter 10, verse or 13, verse 10. Here is the patience and faith of the saints. Again, look at chapter 14, verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Chapter 12, verse 17. The dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. This is the faith of the saints at the end of time. They keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. When you take verse 10 of Revelation 13, chapter 14, verse 12, and chapter 12, verse 17, and put them all together, you realize that at the end of time, in the face of persecution and opposition, in the face of those who do not worship God and whose names are not written in the book of life, you have another group of people who are faithful to God, who will keep his commandments and have the faith of Jesus at the end of time. I want to be one of those. What about you? Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I want to thank you for giving us this time, and I pray you'd please glorify your name as we continue to study, as we continue to learn. I ask that you'd guide us, you'd bless us, you'd teach us, as we wish to be founded not upon the sand as the Antichrist power was. We want to be founded upon the rock, Jesus Christ, with all of his teachings and his truth. Thank you for this, Lord. Continue to lead and guide us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.